a little bit past 5:30, knowing that tardiness is common and in most university settings, we decided to wait a little bit longer than our appointed hour. I was on the verge of saying, with a Freudian slip perhaps on my part, that this is the last lecture of the term in the GAG Security Speaker Series for spring 2016, but it's not. We have one more lecture coming, and that's Professor Hal Brands from Duke University on April 15th, where he'll talk about making the unipolar moment, U.S. foreign policy, and the rise of the post-Cold War order. And it'll be at 4:30 in the afternoon in this room on April 15th. But today, I feel exceptionally privileged to once again welcome probably one of my oldest friends and dearest friends in the discipline, Professor Jack Snyder, whom to most scholars of international politics literally needs no introduction. And people loosely bandy about that term, but in Jack's case, that's exactly the case. And ironically, several of our students couldn't come because they're probably alluding to his work at this very moment because they are writing their PhD IR exams today. There's at least like six people. We hadn't planned it this way. This is it. We would never do this with Jack Snyder in town. But it's worked out that way. And several of our students could not attend this session simply because they are now frantically finishing their exams this evening.
You're not going to make me grade their answers.
That's right, after dinner. That's what awaits you, to see if they got the arguments right. Otherwise, failure awaits them. I'm not going to provide a particularly long introduction because I really want to maximize the time we have. As I said, that Jack is one of the leading scholars in international politics and international security, and he currently holds the Robert and Renee Belfer Professorship of International Relations in the Department of Political Science and the Arnold Saltzman Institute of War and Peace Studies at Columbia University. He's also a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and currently serves as a member of the editorial board of the American Political Science Review and is a member of the Governing Council of the American Political Science Association and also edits the W.W. Norton book series on world politics. This is just a small fraction of an extraordinarily long CV, but I will not dwell on that right now. And instead, I am going to turn the floor over to Jack, who's going to speak on power politics in 1914 and today. And this is obviously quite deliberate because we are in the midst of the 100th anniversary of World War I, which will actually continue all the way till 2018. So we can keep revisiting the subject, and as long as Jack's willing, we can keep having him coming back to talk about yet another aspect of his multifaceted work. But it is indeed a delight to have you back here, Jack. Thank you very much.
As they say, he who tires of World War I is tired of life. So it's a real pleasure to be here to enjoy your glorious new building. I'm appreciative to the audience for coming, especially the people who came at noon to talk about World War I. So we'll see if we can maintain their interest for another bit. So we live in a time right now where there's considerable anxiety over the rise of assertive authoritarian great powers, China and Russia in particular. In the last few years, it seemed like there's a return to crude power politics as the new normal in international relations, the use of force by Russia in Ukraine, assertive moves in the South China Sea. And prominent commentators have been pulling out the analogy to 1914. They've been talking about Barbara Tuchman's book, The Guns of August, which came out shortly before the Cuban Missile Crisis, and which President Kennedy read, and he claims that it affected his thinking in how to manage the showdown with the Soviets in 1962. Commentators who have been making the 1914 analogy to today have included former German Chancellor Helmut Schmidt, Christopher Clark, the author of the blockbuster history of the origins of World War I, entitled Sleepwalkers, which came out a couple of years ago as part of the anniversary of the start of World War I, and was the best-selling hit. There's been a book edited by the scholar Richard Rosecrans, which has various foreign affairs luminaries like Joe Nye writing in it. The title is The Next Great War, idea of the book is 1914 an analogy to a coming confrontation with China? So, personally, when I read these commentaries, I often find myself wondering, well, what exactly is your point? What is it exactly about 1914 that is somehow the same as now? Apart from some vague anxiety that somehow things got out of control of diplomats in 1914, and maybe the return of power politics today will likewise lead things to get out of control. And so can we, maybe go through step by step and think about what some of the analogies or arguments might be, unpack the worries that people seem to have, compare 1914 to now with respect to some specific points, to see whether we can learn anything from them about now. So one thing that many commentators, including German Chancellor Angela Merkel, have been complaining and worrying about is that the weakening of the rules of proper diplomacy and international law is a danger that is exemplified by Putin's takeover of Crimea, the use of the green men moving into eastern Ukraine. Angela Merkel says that this kind of behavior seems so 20th century. She says it reflects, quote, outdated thinking in terms of spheres of influence, which tramples international law underfoot and must not be allowed to prevail. Merkel reportedly told Barack Obama after some conversations that she had had with Putin that he, quote, appeared to be in another world, out of touch with reality, thinking in terms of power politics, rather than thinking in terms of the new rules of the game that are supposed to prevail in law-governed Europe after the end of the Cold War. So this leads me to wonder, well, what rules are we talking about here? And is it Putin or is it Merkel who is out of touch with reality? So some of the concern revolves around the rule of self-determination of peoples, that somehow Putin's incursions into Ukraine are violating Ukraine's right to national self-determination. Well, this is complicated. There's not real clarity about the norm of national self-determination of peoples. In international law, the closest that we get to a clear right of national self-determination is for former colonial possessions of, you know, that are overseas colonies of European former empires. Most of them were deemed to have the right to national self-determination and got independence on that basis. But if it was inconvenient, like in East Timor, the UN said, no, I don't think you get to have national self-determination. This is back in the early 60s. We'll just give you to Indonesia. They'll exercise your national self-determination for you. Thank you very much. You know, thinking about the situation in Ukraine, Putin claims that the Russians in Crimea and the Donbas have their right to self-determination, and so on that basis had these kind of trumped up plebiscites where people could vote to self-determine their political fate. So at best, this is a slippery rule or norm. Maybe Merkel and the other critics see a norm of democracy that not only nations get to self-determination, but they get to do it by, you know, specific democratic procedures, such as the accession to the EU requirements that the former communist states of Eastern Europe had to meet before they were allowed to become members of the EU. And that this is just an obvious rule of the 21st century that shockingly Putin is violating. But Putin, in his turn, points out that the Maidan revolution in Ukraine was a coercive revolution of people out in the streets that overthrew an elected president. And so the norm of democracy in places like Ukraine, where political authority is in the eye of the beholder, is a slippery rule or norm. Well, maybe what Merkel and some of the other critics are concerned about is that Putin violated the norm against illegal aggressive war. So nobody remembers the Kellogg-Briand Pact that made aggressive war illegal back in 1928. But at Nuremberg, they remembered it, and the charges of most of the Nazi war criminals were not anything having to do with genocide, but were mainly charges for having planned and conducted an illegal aggressive war. Most people saw that as kind of ex post facto victor's justice. The International Criminal Court nowadays has kind of left this one in limbo. So genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes that are on, you know, the docket for ICC jurisdiction. They had a conference a couple of years ago where they discussed, well, should we bring back the idea of aggressive war as something that the International Criminal Court could have under its jurisdiction? But I think, you know, if we look at actual practice in international law, what is an aggressive war remains not well defined, to say the least, let alone whether aggressive war is a criminal rule-breaking activity. When people told George W. Bush that he needed to have the UN Security Council's okay to go to war in Iraq, he said, "I don't need a permission slip." And when the Russians were going to veto the NATO intervention to stop ethnic cleansing in Kosovo, all the Europeans agreed with the U.S. that, well, you know, we don't need to go to the Security Council. We'll just do it anyway. The NATO can do it on its own say-so. So if there's a rule against illegal aggressive war, that's a pretty slippery one, too. Sovereignty. Is Putin violating a rule against sovereignty? Well, arguably, sovereignty of nations has been under assault by the UN itself in adopting the so-called responsibility to protect, which gives foreign countries the green light to invade your country if you violate the human rights of your citizens. The rules here are governing this are hardly clear and consensual, since the responsibility to protect is not actually doing very well these days. Is it a rule or is it not? So what about the rules in 1914? How should we think about the role of rules as helping to cause the relatively peaceful 19th century in Europe? And how do we think about the unraveling of rules as being possibly a cause of war in 1914? So after the Napoleonic War, the Concert of Europe established agreements to consult among the great powers in situations where there were dangers threatening the political equilibrium of Europe. Instead of hard and fast specific rules of well-defined do's and don'ts, this agreement to consult was not perfect, and it didn't prevent all the wars, but compared to what happened in the 20th century, the results were comparatively stabilizing. And underpinning a lot of the practice of the Concert of Europe and the conferences of the great powers in the second half of the 19th century was an informal norm of pushing back against those great powers that acted alone. So when France used force to encroach on the Ottoman Empire in 1840, Britain convened the great powers and called France to task and said, no, you didn't get our permission slip, and so you have to pull back from Syria and other places that you conquered. Or otherwise, we're just going to use force to make that happen. The European powers ganged up against Russia in 1878 after it conquered a lot of vassal states in the Balkans, which it took away from the Ottoman Empire. And Bismarck and called a conference in Berlin of all the great powers where they made Russia give back the stuff that it had conquered. My point here is that this kind of Concert of Europe agreement to consult and nobody decides alone is a good if informal rule that reinforces the natural tendency of the balance of power, which is that states join together to stop the aggressive behavior of a strong state that threatens them because it's behaving aggressively. So rules like this are not always honored because they're pretty vague, but they can be stabilizing if they create certain red lines that clarify what's called upon to uphold the balance of power. So in 1914, the violation of Belgian neutrality by the German army was seen in Britain as one of those red lines that said, okay, this is aggressive behavior that needs to be balanced again. We're going to join with the majority of the European continental powers and push back against Germany. Similarly, attacks on neutral shipping and unrestricted U-boat warfare, sinking of the Lusitania brought the U.S. into the war, not because it was just like a legalistic violation of a rule, but because we saw Germany growing too powerful, too aggressive, threatening to overturn the balance of power in the world in a way that endangered the U.S. In contrast, some of the more formal rules were not always helpful. So the Germans counted on the rule against having close-in blockades as a justification for building what they called the risk fleet. And they argued that, well, we can't out-arms race Britain, but we can build enough ships so that they won't be able to blockade near our ports. And the militarist navalists in Germany used this as a justification in their own domestic politics, why it would be smart for Germany to build a fleet. But in fact, the British said, well, that rule's a technicality. We're not going to stick to the close-in blockade rule. We're going to have a far-away blockade, and our navy can handle you. So again, my point is that rules of the game are good if they reinforce the balance of power. That's often stabilizing and prevents war, as it did in the 19th century. But when you have a really dedicated aggressor, they help clarify how you should act in order to enforce the balance of power. I'm told that the Yale History Department had a question that they always asked on their PhD exam, which was, when in European history did the balance of power work best? And almost everybody said, oh, it must be the Concert of Europe because there was peace. And the answer they was looking for was July 31st, 1914, when everybody balanced against aggression. So, we're worried because of rules, but we need to think about what rules are actually stabilizing, not in a legalistic way, but in a supporting power balancing way. Another factor that people are worried about related to this is that there's a fear that we're returning to power politics. You know, one of the reasons that Europeans cling to rules and law is their bad experience with power politics in the 20th century, where they rightly see World War I and World War II as Hobbesian struggles of nations contending for survival and supremacy in a rule-free state of nature, obeying only the laws of power politics. And it is true that in international anarchy with no sovereign or legal power above states, war is always possible and states must amass power to survive in this jungle. Even states that are satisfied with the status quo sometimes need to attack those who might threaten them in the future and do so in a timely way. Before the threat grows. But is it true that aggressiveness is always the smart strategy in power politics? No, in the balance of power, states gang up against the strongest, most aggressive state. And so to avoid being the target of the balance of power, it's wise to let other states appear to be the aggressors and let the balancing process work for you rather than against you. Bismarck did this in a series of wars against Denmark, Austria, and particularly France in 1870. He let the French declare war on him, and in fact, kind of led them down a path of provocation in order to get them to attack him first. The British have had a very successful grand strategic history. After all, they've been on the winning side of all the balance of power wars. They were on the winning side against Napoleon, against the Germans in World War I, against Hitler in World War II. And how did they do this? Partly, it's because of their tradition of appeasement, as Paul Kennedy calls it, that the British are not acting aggressively in preventive wars. They're waiting for the aggressors to make the first move. They're waiting to throw their weight into the balance of power on the side that resists the most aggressive state. The United States also has played this game well. How did the United States get to be so powerful? Well, partly it was because we were wealthy, had a big population, lots of resources, but the historians of World War II and the beginning years of the Cold War have this concept that they call empire by invitation, that the United States kind of hung back. Obama would call it leading from behind and just waited for the Europeans and our other allies to say, come help us contain the rising threatening power of communism. It's much easier to project your power successfully around the globe when people see you as the answer to the threat rather than the threat. Kaiser Wilhelm, Hitler, the Japanese militarist, believed the opposite of the balance of power. They believed that people and states would jump on the bandwagon of the most aggressive power. They believed that the way to make allies was to threaten people by waving the big stick. And if you don't knuckle under to my demands in Morocco, well then I might just invade your country. They saw things in terms of the wisdom of preventive war, and overall their concept was that we can increase our security through expansion. In a balance of power world, that's not generally how things work, and that's why their empires crashed and burned in short order. So, over the past century, the great powers who have done the best job playing a game of power politics have been the democracies. Now, it may not seem so lately, especially for those of you who are not fans of the Bush foreign policy, but our political science studies show that democracies tend to win the wars that they fight, that they're better at picking which wars are prudent to fight. They form stronger alliances than authoritarian states. They learn to correct their mistakes in getting overextended better than the authoritarian powers. It's not that they don't make mistakes, but they correct them better. Of course, this is a relative scale. Compared to the Japanese militarists and Hitler, learning to correct your mistakes is kind of a low bar. So, and why do they do this? They do this because they play by liberal rules among democracies. Democracies never fight wars with each other, and they form strong alliances with each other. But against non-democracies, they play power politics, but they play it prudently and smart. Okay, the third thing that people are worrying about today with the rise of China and the assertiveness of Putin's Russia is the problem of power transition and preventive war. More generally, the BRICS. It seems like the countries that are either non-democracies or shaky democracies or not America's natural allies are rising and challenging the liberal system, ironically, while profiting from participating in the liberal free market system presided over by the international organizations that the US and the other liberal democracies set up at the end of World War II. So here there's relevance for the analogy to 1914, where rising Germany gradually caught up with and overtook the economic power of Great Britain, never quite overtook the naval power of Great Britain, where Germany remained, even while profiting greatly in international trade, remained a more protectionist country than the British, who were its key trading partners. And like, say, China today, is Germany profited from the UK-run open global economy, and the UK naval support for freedom of the seas for trade. The other rising power in 1914 was rising Russia. So Russia was flat on its back after the Russo-Japanese War and the first Russian Revolution of 1905. But a series of tremendously successful agricultural harvests made Russia a wealthy and booming economic power in a very short period of time. Money that they decided to plow back into building strategic railroads with help from French loans, and increasing the size of the Russian army by 50% as planned in 1913 with a culmination date of 1917. So the Germans took one look at this rising juggernaut of Russia and they said, we've been arms racing with Britain and we're losing the naval arms race. And now we're also supposed to keep up with this incredibly rapid pace of Russian armaments buildup. This is impossible. We don't have the tax base in order to do these things simultaneously. And how are we going to deal with this problem? So already in 1912, some of the German militarists were saying, well, we should have a war council to decide on a preventive war to cut Russia down to size before it completes its military increases. And after the confab, they decided, no, we can't do this yet. We need to complete some of our own preparations first. And besides, we're not really sure whether we can win a big preventive war against France and Russia and maybe Britain simultaneously. So let's see how things go. But in the meantime, we'll play hardball. we will try to increase our influence in the Balkan countries, competing with Russia there. We'll try to make Turkey our ally. We'll try to take our military commanders and install them in the Turkish Straits, and then we'll be able to bottle up Russian trade and blockade Russia, and that threat will keep Russia in line. They had an option that didn't require preventive war against Russia and maybe bringing in France and Britain as well. But the thing is that the Russians pushed back, and the Russians stayed firm in the crises over the Balkan Wars in 1912 and 1913. The Russians started planning military moves against the Turkish Straits so that the Germans would not be able to block Russia's huge trade in grain that depended on that route. So that by 1914 July, there was a choice. It looked like the power transition was going to happen, and the Germans were more leaning forward in undertaking that decision. So there's an irony here, though. So this sounds very much like a power politics story. And it sounds like, gee, we don't want power politics to come back today, because if this is what it's like, we don't want to have any part of it. Maybe the 1914 warriors are right. The irony, though, is that what happened in this power politics story leading to preventive war, in my view, was not due to the true logic of power politics, but was rather due to the misapplication of power politics thinking to a bastardized, perverted version of power politics. There actually was no power transition in World War I. The balance of power worked. At the beginning, the first shot of the gun in World War I, the power resources of the German-Austrian alliance were arguably fairly well matched with the power resources of Russia and France. But, you know, as the war continues from 1914 to 1918, you get Great Britain joining in, drawing on the resources of its own manpower, its empire. You get the United States weighing in. And so by the end of the war, the balance of powers completely overwhelming Germany and Austria in its capability. The balance of power works. Exactly the same story happens in World War II. And one of the reasons that it worked in those wars was that the alliance system worked, and there was solidarity between democratic powers that balanced in part against Germany because they saw it. Even Henry Cabot Lodge was for balancing against Germany because he thought that Germany was not a democracy and therefore was an inherent militarist aggressor state. It was not only Woodrow Wilson that thought in terms of democracies and collective security balancing. The rising powers lost because they played the game of international politics too aggressively. So today it's the same. There's no transition. There's no transition in sight. We've been reading more and more about how China is running into the middle income trap, and its economy is slowing down. We've been reading about the economic crisis in the rest of the BRICS that are no longer growing at the 5 to 7 rate, percentage point rate as of a few years ago. So the problem in both eras is belligerent nationalist mindset of rising non-democratic powers, their misunderstanding of what works in power politics, and the domestic political changes that affect their foreign policy thinking. So let me just wrap up by talking just a little bit about the domestic political backdrop of strategic thinking in the countries then and now that were undergoing rapid social change, which created threats to traditionally dominant elites, whether you call them aristocrats and the king, or whether you call them the Communist Party of China, or whether you call them Russian oligarchs, that these elites practice the strategy of divide and rule in their own societies, pitting middle classes against working classes, or pitting different identity groups against each other. The elites relied on prestige strategies in militarized international showdowns to strengthen their own prestige, to exaggerate the threats that they claimed were coming from a hostile encirclement of the status quo powers. This is true in 1914, it's true of Putin, it's true in the period after Tiananmen Square in China. Again, it's not power politics that's the problem, but it's the perversion of it by this kind of nationalist and imperialist ideology. So I'm going to close with what I call the Woody Allen paradox from the movie Sleeper, where you wake up and you find that everything that you thought was good for you is bad for you, and everything that you thought was bad for you, like, you know, hamburgers and chocolate and red wine and foie gras, actually turns out to be good for you. And so what I'm saying here is that power politics can be stabilizing because the balance of power punishes aggressors and should deter them, should make them prudent if they are thinking straight. But they are often not thinking straight because of political ideologies rooted in domestic politics of countries undergoing rapid, incomplete transitions to the market and democracy, especially ideologies of nationalism. I'm saying that liberalism is good, but not for the reasons that you think it's good. Not because liberalism stands for some rigid rules of law that ban war and require a certain format of self-determination. But liberalism is good because it shores up alliances among mature democracies and generally makes democracies better at diplomacy and strategy. The rule of law is good because it strengthens democracies internally, but rigid insistence on rule-based politics in international affairs may not be good if it hinders the practical bargains that recognize realities of power and interest. And this includes bargaining with your allies, but it also sometimes includes bargaining with your enemies and with neutrals, because that's what the game of power politics is about. The best international rules are ones that reinforce rather than ignore the balance of power. So, thanks for the soapbox.
Thanks very much. theory, with contemporary history, with appropriate historical analogies. In fact, I think you already have the makings of an article. All you need to do is put in complete sentences, and this is a perfect article for international security. On that note, let me open up the floor for questions and comments. Yes, please.
How does the United States get the credence to criticize Russia in the Ukraine when the United States, say, invaded Iraq?
Yeah, so this is what the Russians say in their stock in trade. So they'll say,
I don't plan to be a pawn of Russia.
They'll say, well, what we the Russians did in the Ossetia region of Georgia, isn't that exactly the same as what NATO did in Kosovo? And so you're like, how is this different either in fact or in law? And this is one of the interesting things about the contemporary period is that rights abusing dictators are getting very nimble at calling liberal democracies hypocrites and pointing out certain formalistic similarities between their moves and what the democracies do. And so nobody recognizes on a legal basis, the status of Ossetia, except for like three islands that the Russians bribed in order to do it. So this kind of hypocrisy is not always convincing. As you say, even the United States doesn't go according to the rules that the Europeans believe in, when it doesn't find it convenient. And even the Europeans will go along with violations of these rules, like in Kosovo, when they really want to.
Yeah. I would also say, somebody that follows not only Russian behavior, but debate within Russia on foreign policy, that from a Russian perspective, even the most liberal Russian perspective, the cause of fear in the contemporary international system is not their own government, but the American government. And as a violator of international law, the notion that Bush would simply disregard what the UN said and do it alone in Iraq, in Syria, from the perspective of even many Russian liberals, the notion that somehow the United States has the right to arrogate to itself the determination of who ought to rule in Syria and go in there because it doesn't happen to like the guy in power. This is not just a hypocritical manipulation of phraseology or of international norms. There are a lot of folks in Russia that are very afraid of the contemporary international system, because of its unruliness, if you like, its disregard for law, and really see the United States very genuinely as the source of this behavior, and are very concerned about it.
My colleague Tim Fry did public attitude surveys in Russia, trying to get at the question of whether the popular support for Putin is real or whether it's just, people saying what they need to say in order to avoid getting into trouble. And he used the list experiment methodology, where instead of just asking, do you approve of Putin, he would ask, how many of the following Russian leaders' actions do you approve of? Stalin, Brezhnev, Gorbachev, Putin, and that way you could compare the answers in the treatment group to the untreated group, and come out with a metric. And what he finds is that when you do the list experiment methodology, that you get almost the same amount of support for Putin as you do when you just ask straight out, like the normal, you know, Levada Institute polls do. So people really do believe it. You know, how much of this is due to the propaganda environment that people are operating in, I'm not sure. Last semester, I had a Russian undergraduate student who wrote a term paper for my nationalism class explaining that nothing that Russia had done in Ukraine was a cause of the conflict there, that Ukraine really wasn't a real country anyway, and so forth. In the paper consultation on her proposal, I pointed out that, well, maybe there was some literature, like even on our syllabus, that she needed to take into account, like theories of national identity that could make for a richer analysis. And she was very creative. She used all the theories, but didn't change her argument at all. And she's in an environment where she has full information. She's not, you know, stuck with Russian TV. So I, you know, one of the, so there's a book that is going to be coming out soon by a very smart, he's Russian, but he's, you know, works for a Western organization. His argument is that the Russian people supports Russia's policy for the same reason that the Chinese people support the Chinese policy of paving over islands, and that they're sick of humiliation. They want a leader who won't be pushed around and who will stand tall in face of the democracies and the liberal states that have been, you know, humiliating their country for, you know, pick a number, the last 25 years, or in China's case, since the Opium Wars. And that's why they support Putin's realpolitik. Now, that's where I get off the bus, though. I think the argument about the chip on their shoulder because of humiliations has a lot to it. But where I get off the bus is the notion that what Putin is doing or what Xi Jinping is doing is realpolitik. I think it's like the phony caricature of realpolitik that panders to a chip on the shoulder public.
Thank you for a wonderful talk. Yesterday, we just ended a two-day conference. It was SGIS's big coming-out party, America's Role in the World, broadcast on C-SPAN, among other things. And remember, Representative Lee Hamilton ended his introductory remarks by behooving every single panelist over the course of the 2 days to reflect on, well, tell the president, to be blunt, tell the president what on earth he should do, what he should change, what he should keep the same, what are the policy implications. I understand we can have this discussion at a theoretical level as IR scholars, but with that spirit in mind, I'd ask you to just briefly reflect, and if you could turn your attention primarily to East Asia, I was just wondering how, from your perspective as a scholar and as a citizen, you evaluate U.S. policy, let's restrict it to the Obama period, vis-a-vis China's rise. What is working, and what do you think should be done differently if they take the lessons from your analysis?
Yeah, okay, well, let me start with the economic relationship, which I think is by far the most important thing. And let me start with an historical analysis. Not so much 1914, but it's 1929. So in both Germany and Japan in the 1920s, so by 1926, you had in place elected governments in both Germany and Japan that were supported by what's sometimes called a labor export coalition. Urban workers and export-oriented industries exporting consumer goods to liberal democracies, Japanese silk stockings to American ladies, and the Germans were exporting chemicals and what have you. There were security structures in place that took into account the security needs of all the powers. There was the Naval Arms Control Agreement that satisfied both Japan and the U.S. in terms of the naval proportions that kept both secure. In Germany, there was Locarno that guaranteed the frontiers. And the economic arrangements through the Dawes and Young Plan were financing the welfare state in Germany. And so there was, you know, in Japan, there was the Shidahara diplomacy, which was peace-oriented, agreed with the open door of the U.S. and China, kind of mostly. What makes that, so it was the Norman Angel heaven of peace and economic interdependence until the financial system collapsed. And all the financial flows that made the welfare state the dominance of light consumer export goods work. You got protectionism as kind of a follow-on mistake to that. And so in both Germany and Japan, it was decided that, you can't rely on the policies and institutions of liberal democratic great powers. They've destroyed our economies and left us in the lurch. And so now we have to go to plan B, which is to ratchet up our militaries and conquer an autarkic space which will allow direct political control over markets and resources, and also be on a big enough scale that we can fund a big enough military to defend against the liberal democracies that are so untrustworthy. So, you could say that it was a mistake to have deep economic interdependence with China that made it as rich and potentially strong as it is, turning it into a regional, if not a peer competitor. But, it's done. There's no way to roll that back. And so the worst thing that could happen would be if the economic interdependence that sustains Chinese stake in the system were to be threatened. So doing everything possible to institutionalize that and keep it going is job number one. In terms of managing the kind of geopolitics from a military standpoint, Tom Christensen is my student but also my teacher. And so with him, I believe that the U.S. Needs to shore up its allies in Japan and East Asia, but it needs to do that in a way that is fully engaging China and giving China incentives to be a responsible power. That disputes that come along, like disputes over the island, should not be handled in a legalistic way or in a way that is like brittle deterrence, but rather should be handled in a kind of pragmatic bargaining way that avoids head-to-head confrontations while still, you know, making the point that we have allies in the region. So that's my two cents.
So if I could just have the chair will allow one follow-on comment. I think most commentators would agree with almost everything you say. The question is, how do we operationalize that more general advice? And it sounds like you're saying that basic U.S. strategy toward China is fundamentally sound. Is that a fair interpretation of what you're saying?
Yeah. Because it seems to
check most of those boxes.
Yeah. So let me add why is this going to work? I tend to see the United States as being in a very strong position relative to any threat from China. There's the stopping power of water. There's a lot of water between China and Japan. There's even a lot of water between China and Taiwan if we decide we want, for some reason, to defend Taiwan.
They're now calling for high-speed rail.
So the balancing coalition hemming China in is of the little states inviting the U.S. to help is already happening. The potential alliance of balancing between the U.S. and India is, I think, if China does make mistakes and becomes like too threatening, that alliance will, I think, happen kind of automatically and pretty easily. And economically, a rupture in economic relations between the U.S. and China, which would arise out of either an economic crisis per se or through a geopolitical confrontation, would be disaster for China and would be a speed bump for the United States. So the bargaining power is all on the side of the U.S. and the difficulty of the task, I think, is pretty low. As long as we don't get kind of obsessed and say, oh, well, Kimoi and Matsu, like 1 mile from the Chinese coast, we need to defend them to the last Marine. As long as we don't like get stupid like that, it's not a hard task.
Yes.
So actually, you just described a hypothetical disruption of trade between the United States and China as a, how did you say, catastrophic for China. Actually, why mostly? Does China buy something highly important for them from the United States? Or are Chinese exports to the United States so important for them? I mean, the United States is a big market, but it's like, I don't know, 20-30% of the world market, I suppose. So it's big, but like, not a majority of their exports.
Right, so if China has a geopolitical rupture with the United States, it's going to affect not only China's trade with the U.S., but it's going to affect China's trade with everybody.
You mean through embargoes and boycotts and so on?
Pardon?
You mean through the embargoes, boycotts and so on, like it's done with Iran, for example?
Yeah, so I'm just imagining the diplomatic scenario that would give rise to such a thing, and I mean, the whole brunt of my talk was that if this happens, it's probably going to be seen by lots of folks as more China's fault than the fault of the U.S. It's going to be seen as the U.S. pushed into it. The logic of that is based on like everything I just said for the last hour, the argument about the vulnerability of China economically hinges partly on what you think about China's transition to developing its internal market and a consumer-based economy that has an internal basis for economic growth.
It was huge.
So, you know, everybody understands that, like, the Chinese experts understand that they need to do this, but whether they actually can do it, given the nature of their economy and political system, seems very unlikely, or if they do make that turn, it'll be slow, it'll be difficult. In the meantime, they have an economy that's basically an oversized Asian tiger export platform, and that makes them very vulnerable. I mean, you see different figures on this. So,
well, I don't know, I've seen many Walmarts, but I've seen more Walmarts in the United States than in China. So they still can sell their stuff in Walmarts, just they must sell so much stuff in Walmarts in China, I suppose. Or in Iran, or in Thailand, another country they export. But I mean, you have a point, of course. Mm-hmm. It's like an ally who alliance comes up against that, but I don't know. Okay.
Randy? I have a question kind of following your response to Professor Lipp's question. You mentioned how the U.S., the sort of smaller states in Southeast Asia and East Asia, are increasingly inviting the U.S. in as a way of sort of counterbalancing China. And I wonder if there is another way to see that. I'm sort of thinking particularly about Evelyn Goh's argument about omni-entrenchment, right? Where it's not necessarily about balancing against China, but actually bringing both China and the U.S. to the table. Simultaneously, it's in the best interest of these small states. And so my question is, do you think that that's a viable way of thinking about the way that power politics is working in Asia beyond great powers? And is that substantively different in 1914 with smaller states deciding to completely back away with one power?
The small states, well, certainly the small states do not have an interest in, like, war on their behalf between the U.S. and China. That would not go well for them. Objectively speaking, the best thing for the small states would be what's the best thing for everyone, which is to institutionalize security arrangements, have, you know, clear rules of the game that, as I was saying, kind of go with the flow of the natural logic of power and have a kind of political bargain underpinning. But the problem with that is that if you going with the flow in that kind of bargain between the U.S. and China, China has its interests, and it's going to want certain stuff, and it's not going to compromise on certain stuff, so you're going to have to give that to China. And the United States is going to want its stuff. And then who's going to care about the Philippines' claims to some island in that room with the two elephants? So there might be, some circumstances where small actors could see, they might be wrong, but they could see their best move as calling for help from one of the outside protectors. So far, it's looking like they're calling for the U.S. to bail them out. This was a problem in World War I. It's sort of the moral hazard problem, where Germany saw its security as tied to Austria. Austria was too small to take care of itself, but too big to fail. Mm-hmm. So the Germans gave the Austrians a blank check after the Austrians maneuvered them into that situation in the Balkan crisis. So there's I think there's a danger of moral hazard in getting tied to your small allies, which have local interests and are using your power to bail them out. This is just like a basic problem of the United States. Like even in places like Darfur, there was some rebel group who in Darfur that was quoted in the New York Times as saying, "Oh, now the United States cares about Darfur, and we don't have to make any concessions in our negotiations with the Sudanese state because we have the American Air Force on our side." And so it's important to avoid that problem. And this is when Tom Christensen was in the State Department as the Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for East Asia. One of his big jobs that he had to do was to give a speech on the eve of a Taiwanese, quote, independence referendum. It wasn't really, but that's what people were calling it. And Tom had to, on the one hand, walk that line, not abandon Taiwan to Chinese pressure, but at the same time send a very clear signal to the Taiwanese that this was not going to be a moral hazard entrapment situation, that that we are not writing you guys a blank check.
Mike?
Yeah, it's a great lead in the question I wanted to ask about small states from another perspective. And I agree with you that World War I is kind of an endless source of examples and different interpretations. And you were just touching on it in terms of the Balkan crisis right there. So let me sort of follow that up and see if you think there's any lesson for that component of the World War I example. Because there, I think what you could say is that the great powers were trying to play power politics and balance and prevent things from getting out of control. And the Serbs and the other groups in the Balkans had no interest in going along with this. Just went their own way, did their own things, and ended up kind of collapsing the system. And in some ways, Serbia was one of the winners out of World War I. Okay. And basically, it was because they weren't thinking in terms of power politics, and they weren't thinking in terms of liberal rules either. They were just thinking in terms of, getting their sort of power and restructuring the system along the way. And I think an argument can be made that there's some Islamic groups that are acting exactly that way towards the current system. And you said that the United States has a tendency to get a little too connected up to some of its allies, Saudis, Egyptians, pick your example at different sort of times, who are certainly as vulnerable internally as the Austro-Hungarians turned out to be. And there's a potential of being too closely tied to that. So is there any sort of lesson to be drawn from how World War I emerged out of this very small and insignificant, from a global perspective, problem in the Middle East in the Balkan regions with countries supporting terrorism in neighboring countries and conducting, assassination attacks and bomb attacks and things like that, that just led to this sort of global conflagration that no one really wanted? Is there anything like that could happen, you think, in the current system, the way the U.S. is connected to so many different groups in different parts of the world? So.
Yeah, one of my students just wrote a dissertation on this sort of problem, relations between stronger powers and client groups that are kind of unsavory, that you want to support for some kind of tricky geopolitical strategy, but where you don't really want to admit that you're doing it. And her argument was that this creates a kind of double moral hazard because of your need for plausible deniability. And not only do the groups who are getting your guns or money have their own agenda, and are shooting at targets that you didn't have in mind when you gave
right.
them the guns. But even your own agents in the field, in these clandestine aid operations, are operating under rules of plausible deniability, which means your agents, your CIA agents or whoever it is, don't, you can't really call them in because you can't admit that you're controlling
right.
them.
Right.
And so, I mean, this sort of thing is an endemic problem. And you know, Russia and the Balkans before World War I tried to create this thing called the Balkan League,
mm-hmm.
Where they gave you know, the Balkan states had lots of guys under arms, you know, many hundreds of thousands of guys, each one had a rifle, and you know, it was not nothing. And so the Russians looked at that and said, "Great, we can do containment on the Austrians and the Germans, or even maybe more than containment if we support the Balkan League." And so the Balkan states, though, got diplomatic and other backing for Russia, from Russia, and immediately turned around and attacked Turkey. And were so successful that they almost took Istanbul. And the Russians said, "Wait a second, we're supposed to be the ones that get Constantinople." And so there's moral hazard, but the deeper question, which is really what you're asking, is, well, why do you get sucked into
right.
moral hazard? And the most general point that I would make is that if you have a view of power politics in the rough and tumble of international relations that says security is always precarious, and expansion and aggressive behavior is the best
mm-hmm.
way to solve your security problem, that tends to go along with kind of a knife edge view of, we can either win or we could lose, and it's a really close thing, and so we need to have every little ally and every little stratagem and every little geopolitical outpost
mm-hmm.
needs to be on our side. And so we have to support the XYZ rebel group, or we have to defend some position that's like really way out there
mm-hmm.
on a limb for us, because we need everything in order to be strong and ubiquitous enough to win. Whereas if you take what's generally the more correct view, that, you know, it's, again, Obama, don't do dumb stuff. Defend the stuff that's easy to defend. Defend the people that are pretty well organized and have a coherent government. Defend the people that are pretty much likely to be your friends and cooperate with you anyway as your main priority, and be very skeptical
mm-hmm.
about getting out on a limb for other purposes, then you won't have these moral hazards. You'll design your strategy so that, you know, defense is the best defense.
Okay.
Yes.
What about the war on terror that the United States supposedly is engaged in, where they bomb nations that were not at war with? They pack places in Pakistan and Somalia, and, you know, even Yemen and so on, officially at war with. But what are the rules of that? I mean, where does all that get justified? How do you deal with it?
Yeah, well, there's a twofold debate going on about that. One is a debate about whether it works. And some people say, you know, yes, it works. You know, we just killed however many terrorists it was a couple of days ago in Somalia.
You have to take their word for it.
And other people say, you know, maybe you did, but you pissed off 10 times as many who are going to sign up to be the new wave of terrorists. So there's the does it works discussion, and then there's the normative and legal discussion. You know, we're doing targeted killing of sometimes even people who are American citizens, and who decides this? And one of the difficult parts in this for me and for Obama is that, you know, when you ask, so Derek Chollet is a Columbia PhD who's been a national security advisor to Obama, and he's writing a book about his role in the Obama grand strategy. And in that book, which is not out yet, but it's going to be out fairly soon, it's an excellent book, he makes the point that Obama's use of precision in the war on terror, targeted killings and drone strikes, is of a piece with Obama's realpolitik in respect to leading from behind, with respect to responding to Putin in Ukraine with what was, after all, really quite moderate economic sanctions, rather than knuckling under to the calls from, you know, all the Beltway geniuses about how we should be, like, shoveling money and weapons into the hands of these crooks in Ukraine. If the Chollet argument is, you know, a correct characterization of the Obama strategy, he's saying that this is like smart power, it's realpolitik, and it's the good, real, effective realpolitik, because you're not out on a limb, because you are like getting impact and not getting into quagmires that you can't extricate yourself from, and you're also not engaging in foreign adventures that are politically unsustainable at home. Now, I don't necessarily agree with that myself, but if you take the argument seriously, it creates a puzzle for the kind of argument that I've been making.
You used to think a person was innocent until proven guilty. You just have to take their word that they're killing people. The whole thing smells bad.
There's a whole debate as to, you know, whether the right normative criteria for this situation are, you know, do the rules of war apply, rules of crime apply, or, you know, the best thing is neither the rules of war nor the rules of crime apply, and we just do whatever we make up, which is pretty much the way the game has been played.
Gets away with what they want to get away with. We're the strongest power on the earth. We make the rules.
Yeah, but there's also the argument that countries that are under terrorist attack are generally given a little latitude in how they respond to it, because people realize that it is a tough problem, it's a special case. The rules, you know, that were designed for other things apply awkwardly at best to these kinds of circumstances. So I'm not saying like right or wrong, but I'm just saying politically, you can get away with stuff in a war on terror that otherwise you wouldn't be able to get away with.
On that note, we bring this to a close. Thank you very much for coming. And I'm deeply grateful to Jack for coming back, I think almost a third time in the last couple of years. And this has just been a marvelous day, and I'm most grateful to you for both your presentations. Thank you again.
Thank you.